John Henry was a steel driving man. Yes, he went down. Well, he went down. You just take this hammer and carry it to my captain. Oh, tell him I'm gone. Won't you tell him I'm gone?
A little bit about how you first made a record way back in 1927. Remember?
Ah, yeah. 28, well, pardon me, and 29. To learn to play guitar, I had no teaching. I was just an 8-year-old boy. I'd go in and go to bed, but I wouldn't go to sleep. I kept thinking I'd get the guitar. I kept on at that till I learned to play one number. And I said, wow. And when I learned to play that number, why? I didn't care who heard it then.
The Odyssey of Mississippi John Hurt. From his original discovery in the 1920s to his rediscovery in the 60s, is the saga of American epic in microcosm. In the abandoned hamlet of Avalon, Mississippi, we meet John Hurt's granddaughter, Mary Frances Hurt, outside the humble cabin where he once lived.
You know, when I talk about Avalon and they say, oh, it's nothing there, it's just a sign. But I remember where my parents used to live. And I remember all of the families that used to live there, the store that used to be there, and the cotton gin, and everything. This town existed. And it was a real place, real families, real people lived there.
It was a tiny little village with three grocery stores. When I say grocery stores, the stores contained everything from plows and even mules.
When I was a kid, he lived above the store, and he would be standing always by the mailbox, just like he was waiting for somebody to come up the hill. And he always had this radiant smile. His smile was like a pebble thrown in the lake, and it would just spread. And it was just so wonderful. People just knew him as Mississippi John Hurt. But he was Daddy John.
The store here was a gathering place, especially on Saturday night. John Hurt has spent many hours playing music inside the store and on the porch out here. When he started recording records, it just kind of made everyone here happy.
In 1928, Tommy Rockwell, a producer for OK Records, and his engineer, Bob Stevens, traveled to Memphis in search of new artists.
These are remarks from Bob Stevens, the engineer who was there with Tommy Rockwell in Memphis in 1928. Tommy Rockwell and I went on our field trip to Memphis where we already had some acts set up to record. Tommy told me he could take care of things, and he suggested that I take a trip down the Mississippi Delta and see what I could find in the way of race stuff, and then come back inland for hillbilly stuff. So, I stopped in all the little towns and the local record stores to see what was going on, and I wound up in Jackson, Mississippi, and I thought, the hell with it, this is ridiculous. So I suggested we organize an old-time fiddling contest. The winners would get an OK contract. While this was going on, Mr. Stevens adds, we kept hearing about some wild blues singer named Mississippi John Hurt, so we set out to find him. The trouble we had. Finally, we tracked him down late at night. We had to put the headlights onto the door of his shack before we knocked. This guy came to the door, damn near turned white when he saw us. He thought we were a lynching party. We told him who we were, and he asked us in. He threw a few logs on the fire. He took out his guitar and starts to sing. He was great. So we booked him into Memphis. He made a few sides for us, and then he disappeared again. Well, he didn't really.
In Memphis, Tommy Rockwell and Bob Stevens recorded John Hurt in the McCall Building.
Frankie went down to the corner saloon, didn't go to be gone long. She peeped through the keyhole of the door, spied out within Alice's arm. He's my man, and he done me wrong.
Frankie is based on the 1899 shooting of Albert Britt by his lover Frankie Baker, after she caught him in bed with another woman. As Frankie and Johnny, it became a popular standard, recorded by Jimmy Rogers, Bob Dylan, Stevie Wonder, and Elvis Presley. But John Hurt sang an earlier version, closer to the true story.
Frankie shot Albert, and she shot him 3 or 4 times. Says, stroll back, out to smoke him a gun, let me see his Albert dying. He's my man, and he done me wrong.
After the recording session, John Hurt went home to Avalon. A few weeks later, he received a record in the mail. The only problem, he had nothing to play it on.
So he had to ask the woman whose land he was looking after the cows on, would she kindly play the record for him? So she said, well, now, all right, John, I'll leave you. Stand outside the screen door and I'll crank it up for you so you can hear it, you know. And she got it done, took it back, said, oh, that's you on that record, isn't it?
That woman's daughter is Annie Cook, and she remembers that day.
We had the old-time big troller that you'd crank, and it was just unbelievable, just like when we got the first call, how exciting something like that was then.
Frank and the judge walked down the stand, they walked out side to side. The judge says to Frankie, you're gonna be justified for killing a man, and he done you wrong.
Isn't that pretty? I think it is.
Before long, John Hurt received a letter from Tommy Rockwell asking him to come to New York City for more recordings. There, he recorded one of his most popular songs, Candyman.
Well, all your ladies all gather around, that good sweet candy man's in town. It's the Candyman, it's the Candyman. Just 9 inches long. He sells his fast to hog and chew his cone. It's the candy man. It's the candy man.
Homesick and lost in the big city, Hurt composed Avalon Blues, a heartfelt tribute to his hometown.
Out in New York this morning, just about 9:30. Thought of my mom and Avalon.
Hurt returned to Avalon, picking up odd jobs to survive, and waited to hear more from OK. But the depression hit, and the entire record business fell on hard times. Hurt wrote to the company in New York, offering to make new recordings. His letters went unanswered. For 35 years, he eked out a living by sharecropping and minding cows, only playing music for his family and neighbors. By the 1950s, Mississippi John Hurt's records were forgotten, except by a small circle of collectors searching junk store record bins for his battered 78s. He had recorded 20 songs for OK. 7 of those performances have never been found.
It's the Candyman.
Archivists like Michael Brooks have devoted their lives to preserving the surviving record masters, which are known as metal parts.
These metal parts are really part of history because music reflects what goes on in a country, in the world. And this is really American history here. And there were hundreds and hundreds of thousands of these made. And in the Depression, metal was a good source to melt down and sell. A popular tune from 1926 meant nothing in 1934, so toss it out. And then the next decimation of these parts came in World War II, which was far greater, because everyone was looking around for scrap metal. Everything went to the war effort. So, you know, a Louis Armstrong and Carter family, Jimmy Rogers, so melted down, given to the government, and remade into weapons of mass destruction. And you think, you know, there might be a Mississippi John Hurt being dropped over Germany or something. So there isn't that much left anymore. I would say that metal parts pre-mid-30s, I would say 90% is gone. So we are trying to reconstruct what happened in the world, what the popular music was, and we have to scratch around to find things.
In the 1950s, a few small record labels began releasing vinyl compilations of rare recordings by little-known figures like Bascom Lamar Lunsford, Sleepy John Estes, and Mississippi John Hurt.
This is a copy of the famous Harry Smith Anthology of American Folk Music, the way it appeared when Folkways Records first published it. John Hurt was represented by two cuts on that record. This is the original edition. It had the red cover, and if you took the records out too often, the edges began to split up on the ends, and this is from 1952. This is like 1,000 years ago. It's very much a product of its time.
Soon, adventurous young record collectors were heading south in search of the artists who had made those precious 78s. But Mississippi John Hurt seemed impossibly obscure, and few even dreamt he was alive.
Avalon, my hometown, always on my mind. Avalon, my hometown, always on my mind. Pretty mamas in Avalon want me there all the time.
Then one day, a collector named Dick Spotswood heard a rare copy of Avalon Blues.
There was one John Hurt title that none of the Hurt fans, such as we were in the late 1950s, had ever heard. And the first thing I heard was the lyric that says, Avalon's my hometown, it's always on my mind. And so I extrapolated from that that there must be a place in Mississippi called Avalon. And went to the Atlas to look it up, and there it was. It was clear by just looking at the map that it wasn't anything more than a speck on the road. When another friend decided that he was going to go down to the Mardi Gras in New Orleans in 1963, I looked at the map again and I said, it's not too far out of your way to stop by Avalon, Mississippi, and see if anybody has ever heard of John Hurt. And so he did, and the first person he asked gave him directions to John Hurt's house.
He goes, are you the person that made this song? He goes, yeah. And he said, can you play the song? And Daddy John responded, I could if I had a guitar. And the guy had a guitar, so he played this song for him. And he goes, do you know that how famous you are? And Daddy John's like, no. You know, he goes, no, he had no idea.
Looking for the best way to introduce John Hurt to a world of new listeners, Dick Spotswood managed to get him booked as a last-minute attraction for the 1963 Newport Folk Festival.
Dick Spotswood.
Dick. I've been asked to say a few words about John, so I'll make it brief as possible so you can hear him play himself. When we found him this spring, he hadn't played guitar for years, but he picks it up now and plays like a champ.
It's been quite a while since I did any of this, and I'm real happy to be with y'all. You know, I can't help but be happy. I remember doing much of this. Why? I was with the OK Company, record for them 28 and 29. So, Spotswood discovered me down in Howland, Mississippi. Why, I thought it was real funny. I said, why? Whatever I did, kill the FBI looking for me. I ain't getting there. So, the first little number I do is Stagger Lee. Everybody, but Bruce Staggerly, that bad man.
old cruel Stagley.
John Hurt was the surprise hit of the festival and inspired a new generation, including the young Taj Mahal.
When I first heard John Hurt's music, it was like he was somebody I was looking for. He was like the musical grandfather you were looking for. He had another key to the musical universe. And I tried real hard to learn how to play like him, you know. Too, like Lewis Collins. Lewis Collins was about something that happened real close to him. Lewis Collins got into a fight with somebody and got shot. And instead of taking it from the bar fight scene, which is in the song, he talks from the Lewis Collins' mother. And, you know, Miss Collins weep, Miss Collins moan, moaning for her. Lewis Collins that's dead and gone. The angels laid him away. You know, the gentleness really came through in him.
Record collector Ken Swerlis shot footage of John Hurt playing Lewis Collins in a small club in Los Angeles. It's the only known color footage of Hurt performing.
Miss Collins weep, Miss Collins moan, to see her son Lewis leaving home. The angels laid him away. They laid him 6 feet under the clay. Angels laid him away.
This place, the sounds, the beauty of all of this, he loved that. And he came early one morning just to make sure that he just caught the right rays and the sun and everything. And he had a stroke. He never recovered from that stroke. And I would say it was a tragedy, but he died the way he loved. And he's buried in this place. He's home. Daddy John is home.
When you always heard that black was beautiful, and John was one beautiful man. He was kind, and he was loved people, and people loved him. I just wish we had more like him.
John Henry was a steel-driving man. Oh, he went down. Well, he went down. This is the hammer that killed John Henry. But it won't kill me. It won't kill me. It won't kill me. Down.
Were you surprised at the enthusiasm when your work came up here?
Well, I was. I was because I had never, you know, I made records and that was the end of it. Made some records that goes back home. I had never did anything more. I more than just play little music around through the country every once in a while.
You didn't think of it as folk music at the time, did you? At that time, you didn't call it folk music.
This music, that's right. But, well, I didn't know what this folk music was. And I began to kind of learn what they mean now by folk music.
Well, what do you think they
mean? I think they mean songs that what I call maybe died out, you know. It went back and they renewed them. That right? Am I right?
Whatever you think it is.
Well, you know, I read it in the Bible. It says the older men teach the younger ones. I'm glad I got something that they want. That's right.